Good morning, everyone. Thank you. Good morning, po.
Good morning.
To all the mothers, we would like to greet you. Happy Mother's Day. May the Lord bless us continually as we parent our children. Okay, shall we all stand and worship the Lord? We have a verse actually over there. So the Bible says in Psalm 106, verse 1, "Praise the Lord, O give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His loving kindness is everlasting." Amen to that. So in spite of our shortcomings, the Lord remains faithful. The Lord remains good. So why don't we sing about His goodness? Amen? Okay.
You're
our good Lord. Amen. Shall we greet each other? Shake hands, greet the mothers. And the not mothers, the three mothers.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
When we remember what the Lord has done for us on the cross, we are called to deny ourselves and commit ourselves to God. May it be our prayer and our desire to be molded, be guided, and be led by Him every day of our lives, because it is our goal to please Him in every way we can.
Thank you. God, we want to lift you up today. And Lord, it is a special day where we want to celebrate our mothers. And I just pray that every act of praise to our mothers is an act of worship to you. For you have given us them. You have built them up. You are the one who raised them. You are the one who molded them and shaped them. And it is their love and their compassion towards their children, Lord, that we are thankful for. God, we want to thank you because you are good to provide the mothers that we need. What an honor and a blessing it is to be both receiver of that blessing and to be that blessing. So Lord, we want to thank you. You are such a good God. You who invented the family. You who raised the position of motherhood, Lord. We want to thank you. And God, in this beautiful day, and with all our plans coming up next week and the months and the years, Lord, we pray that they are not devoid of you. That nothing we do is missing you. And Lord, that you are in everything, in our lives, in our workplace, in our school, that you are living a life that you have willed for us. And you are good, Lord, and that's why we worship you. You are faithful, and that's why we praise you. Thank you, Lord.
Praise team. Good morning to all. Good morning to our mothers. Mothers. If this is your first time to live in the world, we welcome you with the love of the Lord. And we invite all of you to stay. We're going to have our lunch together. Now, the children, you have class today?
I don't know.
You don't know? Well, the teacher probably know. That's a good answer. They're singing. Okay, well, why don't we invite them to come? As they will sing a special tribute to their mom. All right? Okay.
Thank you.
love my mom because she's always there for me. Really mean to me. Every day I will.
the children can go to their class now. The smaller one, the younger one. Oh, that is a song that we could count on our mothers, isn't it? They just probably count a different way. It's a special day, isn't it? We have a lot of memories about our moms. Raise your hand who have a mother. Or who had a mother? Or those who didn't raise your hand, what happened to you? How did you come about? We have lots of memories. One, two, three of it. You love God because of your mothers. You love mothers because of what God has done. One. Two different things, but it's the same. Can you stand up and just say, what is one thing that you still remember about your mom? Maybe some are still living, and maybe some are going to heaven already. I just want to hear something good that you remember about your mother. Stand up and say it. The very last one, I said three.
First thing
I'd
like to recognize my mom is in heaven. She is a hard worker, always like the best for us.
Amen. And all mothers are, isn't it? Amen. Now, let me say this. Your mother, most of you are still living. You have opportunity to say thank you to them and lift them up and honor them. Take that. As an advice, because we're their God. Their God. That's a good introduction. Let's stay put in there. Now, I'm not sure if I have enough words or even eloquence to articulate or express the true value of a mother. Excuse me for a second. I think it just, I sounded like Moses in the... sounded like Moses in the wilderness. I like to sound like more natural. Okay. And there is an echo, I think. Let me start with this. That's better. One mother says the joy of motherhood is what a woman experiences when all her children are finally in bed. Another mother talking to an old close friend has said, remember, before I was married, I had three theories about raising children. Some of them I don't understand. Well, now I have three children and no theories at all. One mother who had three children was asked, if you had it all to do over again, would you have children? Yes, she replied, but not the same ones. One thing I learned yesterday, for those men who went to Brookswood, a new defensive lineman for the BC Lions, DeQueen Evans. Let me paraphrase it, not exactly the word, but this is what he said yesterday. He said this, you listen to your mother and surely you're going to have a happy ending. Well, that's very true. All we got to do, children, is to listen to our mom. Mom knows the best. Your mother knows what's good for you. And I've used this passage. I was looking at several women in the Bible. There's the Timothy's grandma and mom and Louis and there's Hannah. And there are other mothers in the Bible, but always going back, she is a hero to me, Mary. And I know that I used this text before, but it's a different view right now, and I hope that God will give us a very good encouragement to all mothers and for all of us children. Because mothers are our heroes. They're nothing more powerful than the prayers and tears of a mother. Think about the mother's hug. Think about the compassionate touch of every mother to their child. And I know I'm speaking to a lot of mom here this morning, and probably more than the fathers. And I read that out of the 69 kings of France, only 3 were really loved by their subjects. And that these 3, by the way, were the only ones raised by their moms instead of a nanny, instead of a tutor or a guardian. You see the influence of a good, godly mother. It just may be true what Napoleon said, the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. There's a PowerPoint for that. And Ralph Waldo Emerson has said, men are what their mothers make them. I'd like to see that. You're behind 2 frames now. Today I want us to look at a mother who knows best, who God chose to raise the Savior of the world. And as we look at, like I said, Mary, supposed to be my hero, and your hero. I know it's not Christmas today. No. It's not Christmas today, but yet I thought of using Mary. Because we're going to see that she is a model of motherhood. Turn to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. Verse 26. Now in the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee called Nazareth. The virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the descendants of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And coming in, he said to her, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was very perplexed at this statement and kept pondering what kind of salutation this was. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and for that reason the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God. And behold, even your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age, and she, who was called barren, is now in her 6th month. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, the bondslave of the Lord, may it be done to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. What a great story, isn't it? And immediately you find in the text that Elizabeth bore a son. That was John, the forerunner of Christ. Particularly their cousins. Now, on this thing, I find it very interesting that God has chosen a little town, a girl, a young girl from this little town of Nazareth. A town with a bad reputation. And scripture even says, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" A few of us have been to Nazareth. I'm talking, because they're going to go there, and Pastor Austin and the rest of them will be going the next month. And is actually, even as today, you go to Nazareth, it's different from the other place in Israel. It's dirty. God chose a humble cottage and tapped a girl on the shoulder who was a teenager and chose her to be the mother of Jesus. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the God who became a man. And two times in our text, we find that the angel Gabriel told Mary that she was found favor with God. Why? You notice, twice. What was there about Mary that had caught our God's attention? And I know that we will not find the answer directly from our text or from the scriptures, but nevertheless, the answer is hidden in this brief account of the life of this young lady. I found part of the reason why God chose Mary, and it is this. God knew her. Knew this young girl, and also knew what she would become. God is an all-knowing God, and he chose this young girl, young lady, young woman, a special lady. Mary, as a mother, knows best, both for herself and for her God and for her child. First, Mary knows best, and she had found favor with God because of who she was. This is a message for our mothers. This is a message for all of us. This is a message for those who will become mother, as God had called you. So number one, I think God favored Mary because we find in the text that she had a right perspective. She had a right perspective of life. She had a right perspective of who God is. She had a right perspective of what God desires, what God wants for her life. And I wonder, if you will be Mary and Gabriel would tap on your shoulder and say, behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son. I wonder if you would marry. No doubt it would have troubled you, right? Am I correct? If Gabriel all of a sudden in the middle of the night showed up on your bed, Christelle, you're smiling, and Gabriel told you, behold! How would you respond? Me, Lord? Well, now in this story, she was engaged already with Joseph, right? We all know the story in this. An engagement in that day were much more serious than they are today. For instance, in the culture that they were in, an engaged woman could not be divorced without a bill of divorcement. If suspected of unfaithfulness, she could be divorced or even put to death. If her fiancé died, she was considered as a widow, and child born during the engagement was considered illegitimate. So now think about what's going on in the mind of this young lady. Some troubling possibilities for Mary could be one, her teenage pregnancy. She was in a culture hostile to women, by the way, don't forget that. And behold, you will become a pregnant lady. You'll conceive. You'll conceive a man who will be the savior of the world. Number two, her reputation in Nazareth. It is at risk. She can be accused of unfaithfulness against Joseph and possibly, like I mentioned, death on that culture. Man, if we have that culture today, we probably have a lot of dead women. Mary could have said this, Lord, I'm just a girl. I'm so young. I'm not ready to be a mother. I'm not wealthy. I'm not ready, I'm not educated, I'm not worthy of this. Maybe it would be better if you got someone else. That's easy. But what did Mary say? Let's go back to our text, verse 38. What happened? Mary said, "Behold, the bondslave of the Lord. May it be done to me," Mary says, "according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Did you see that? That Mary, first of all, God knew who she was because of the right perspective. She knows. Mary knew who God was. Mary knew that the God that talking to her was the God Almighty, and knows her. He knows Mary. He knows that Mary's a servant. Mary was God's servant, and nothing was impossible if God says it. Mary knew that it would happen even if she didn't really understand what Gabriel was saying. Mary accepted it. She had the right perspective about her role as a mother. It was an honor and a blessing to her. She had the right perspective. If you go fast forward this story in the next chapter of Luke, chapter 2, the folklore, chapter 2, where we find Mary's song in chapter 2. It's recorded in here. It tells us how she rejoices and blessed on what God was going to do in her life. Mary saw the motherhood as an honor and as a gift. Now, mothers today should be like Mary. They need to have the right proper perspective of who God is, of what life is about, or what God's purpose for their lives as mothers. But don't forget that they should know that they are servants of God in all things, and especially in raising God's children. Mary had the responsibility to raise Jesus. All mothers shared the same responsibility raising children. So what comes to mind first is it will be overwhelming, right? As a mom, you are inadequate, you feel, for that responsibility. But yet, back to verse 37, it says this: "For nothing will be impossible with God." See that verse 37? As a mother, be reminded of this verse: nothing will be impossible with God. Now, let me just pause for a moment in here. What did you notice here? Did you notice something? Verse 37, mothers, it does not say nothing is impossible for God. Did you notice? Although that's correct. Nothing wrong with that. I'm trying to make a point here, mothers. Nothing is impossible with God. So what are we saying now, mothers? Mothers, with God on your side, nothing is impossible. Do you believe that? It's not for God. Nothing will be impossible when you are cooperating with God, when you are doing the motherhood with God. You see the point? Like marriage, nothing is impossible. Doing all the chores in the house, doing all the motherhood responsibility, if you are with God. I'm not a mother, I'm a dad, but I know how hard to become a mother. But we could do it if God is on our side. There are times that mothers, you are frustrated with your children's behavior. You are frustrated with their attitude sometimes. You're losing your energy sometimes because a lot of things to do that it seems doing mother's work. has no end. Testimony. Mothers, am I correct? It seems that there's no end. Every day, you're doing this, you're doing that, every day. Preparing the lunch, cleaning them up. That's mother's responsibility. It seems that there's no end. You heard people say mothers are good drivers of their kids. Taxi driver. Mothers, you're a good cook. Mothers are janitors. Mothers are housemaids, and so on. But it is an honor that God entrusted your children to your care, and nothing is impossible with God. Psalms 127. Let me remind you, it says in the message, I use the message, verse 3. Though you see the children are God's best gift, the fruit of the womb is generous legacy. They are a real blessing, a reward from God. I like to remind all of us. God, the Father, looked upon Mary with favor because Mary had the proper right perspective. And it is an honor and a blessing. It is a gift from God. And with God, nothing is impossible to do motherhood. Number two, because Mary also, not only the right perspective, that Mary has a good, solid, biblical background, a foundation that she had. How do we know that Mary had a solid foundation? That she was grounded in the Word of God? Very easy to tell, because the next chapter, like I mentioned in Luke chapter 2, records for us Mary's song in these 10 verses. It is quite evident that Mary knew the scriptures, as there are at least 30 phrases or words that echo the truths from God's word, particularly the Old Testament that they had then. And look at chapter 1, 46. Not chapter 2, but chapter 1, 46, where the Magnificat is. Mary said, "My soul exalts the Lord," and so on and so forth. You see, Mary knew the scriptures. And she went beyond that, and it was one who enthusiastically praised her God. She recognized here that God is the mighty one, verse 49, chapter 1. That he is holy and that his mercy reaches out to those who fear him, filling the hungry with good things. Mary can be an example to all mothers. A mother who knows her God and his word. A mother who praises her child, but at the same time praising her God. It will make a difference in her children. I'm talking to the mothers, and this is also a day where we celebrate grandmothers. Grandmothers have a special ministry also, just like the mother. I think there's a passage in Psalms, and I don't want to miss this thing. In Psalm 78, verse 3, you can just follow me. Verse 3, or maybe I start with 1. After 7. Listen, O my people, to my instruction, incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old. Verse 3. Which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not conceal them from their children. See that? But tell to the generations to come the praises of the Lord, and his strength and his wondrous works that he has done. For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers, that they should teach them to their children, that the generation to come might know even the children yet to be born, that they may arise and tell them to their children that they should put their confidence in God and not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments. And you go to the New Testament in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, we find a beginning. For I am mindful of the sincere faith within you, which first dwelt in your grandmother Lewis and your mother Eunice. And I'm sure that it is in you as well. 1 Timothy 1, 5. Paul commanded to Timothy his sincere faith in God because of the influence and the teaching and the praying of the mom and the grandma. Timothy's mother and grandmother as a solid godly foundation, and they passed God on to Timothy. So for those of you who are grandmothers, you know what we're talking about. I know we're so blessed that Louis is spending time so much with MJ, of course with Lincoln, but there's a great not only responsibility, but it is an influence that we have to our grandchildren. It's a blessing. But the question today, if Mary had a solid foundation, mothers, do you have a solid foundation? In the Word of God? Who God is? How well you know our God Almighty? Do you have His Word hidden in your heart and in your mind? It is a question to ask yourself, mothers. So you have all these things to support you and guide you in your life and in your motherhood. Do you know His Word well enough to pass it on to your children? If you don't, unfortunately and sadly, you have nothing to teach, and you wonder why your children, your grandchildren, don't result as an older adults that you wanted them to become, God wants them to become. We love to recite Psalms 127, verse 1, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain. Who builds it? We're all familiar with the family of Wesley. Product of the family is John and Charles. Susanna Wesley, the mother of John and Charles. They started the Methodism. Did you know that Susanna spent 1 hour each day praying for her? How many children? 17. She has 17 children. It was noted that she took its child aside for a full hour every week to discuss spiritual matters. They probably didn't discuss Telesera or the current movie. They discussed the Bible. She discussed the Bible with her children. No wonder two of her sons, Charles and John, were used for God to bless people in England and others. 17. But how many children do you have? Most of our families have two. You spend time with your children? A good question now for us all. God has chosen Mary because of her right perspective and solid godly foundation. Mothers, if you want God's favor, may you all become Mary. Mary knows best, and as a result, she had found favor with God because of who she was, and secondly, because of who she would become. An all-knowing God knows that she will have two characteristics, I can assure you, that every mother should have. First, Mary, we find here in the text. Mary was a protected mother, which means safeguarding her children from anything that would harm them and would deter God's plan for them. She was very involved in the life of the child. Mothers should be involved in the life of your children, protecting them. mothers have a natural instinct to protect their young, don't they? Even animals do that. So if I say, if cat's mom, dog's mom, or even other animals had the instinct to look after their young ones, if mothers don't do the same, the animals are better than the mother. It seems that this is something that God has wired into the creation of mother. Mother's instinct of protection goes beyond even human relationships. From the moment that Jesus was born, his life was in danger. The wicked King Herod was on the throne and he sought the life of Jesus. We all know the story. It forced Mary and Joseph to flee. They went to Egypt. Mary protected Jesus from Herod and from many other things that would hurt the child. And it's interesting, Luke says in chapter 2, verse 19, after saying how the shepherds told what they had heard, but Mary, it says in verse 19, Mary treasured all those things, pondering them in her heart. By the way, the Greek word used here, the word treasure, is a word that means an intense protective keeping. And then you find in chapter 2 about Simeon and the prophetess Anna, who were given glimpses of them supernaturally of Jesus. It's quite interesting in the next chapter here, verse 33. And his father and mother were amazed at the things which were being said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rise of many in Israel and for a sign to be opposed. And you jump to 36. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, in the tribe of Aser. She was advanced in years and had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. And then as a widow to the age of 84, she never left the temple, serving night and day with fastings and prayers. At the very moment she came up and began giving thanks to God and continued speaking of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. And when Jesus was a little older, again we find Mary. Chapter 2, verse 51 of Luke, it says, and he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and he continued in subjection to them. Listen, it says, and his mother, Mary, treasured all those things in her heart. His mother treasured all those things in her heart. But apparently, she knew and was aware of the danger surrounding Jesus. Mary protected him. What is a reminder for mothers, godly mothers? Do you remember your reaction the first time your child get hurt? Perhaps you think about the stairs, maybe some nails in there or whatever, or staples. You worry, you're concerned. Electrical outlets in the home. What about falling from chairs? And so on and so forth. What about someone said something the first time that is mean and hurting to your child? Probably Myra, that's why he sent Daniel to Taekwondo. But mothers have that instinct to protect and to care for their children. And now when they're grown up, tell me what are those dangers our children are facing today. Let me say this, they're more deadly than those stairs and those electrical outlets. Think about low self-esteem. Think about smoking, drugs, alcohol. What about peer pressure? What about sexual immorality, fornication? What about suicide?
What about internet? Mothers, of course. Of course, with the help of the fathers. Only I rephrase that. Mothers, of course, with the leadership of the father. Sound better? Dad? You have your time next month. But they must protect children from all this. From the worldly value system. From those TV, music programs, all those things out there promoting that are in opposition to biblical values. Today is very hard. Tools are given and easy to comprehend and understand, but there are subtle things that don't seem bad, but tend to crowd out God. Your priorities could be your sports, could be your school, could be your many activities that you brought into the lives of your young children and others. Of course, your protection comes with discipline to prepare them to stand alone when they're grown up. God looks favor upon Mary because she would responsibly protect her child as he grows up. And God expects all mothers to do the same for their children. Kids. I have some kids sitting with their parents today, especially with your mom. What gift did you give to your mom on this Mother's Day? Adrian is smiling. What did you give to your mom, Adrian? Let me, sorry? Wow. You're a good boy. Good son. Let me tell you a story. A 6-year-old and a 4-year-old sister presented their mom with a Mother's Day present. It was a small, skinny house plant. While it wasn't the finest looking plant, they had brought it with their own money, and mom was thrilled, of course. They used their money. She hugged and kissed her children and told them she loved them very much for thinking of her. Johnny said, "There was some other flowers we wanted to buy for you, mom, but we didn't have enough money." "Oh yeah," said Sister Susie. "They had a real nice bunch of flowers at the shop that we were going to buy. But I love this plant," said the happy mother. "I know, mom," said Johnny. "But these flowers would have been perfect for you. They were in a wreath, and they had a ribbon that said, 'Rest in peace.'" "And you're always asking us for a little place so you can rest." "Actually, it costs more. The one with R.I.P. on it." But Mary was a protective mother. She was a protective mother, and I don't know about your mothers. You have that instinct. You have that responsibility to protect your sons and daughters. Secondly, she was also a loving mother. No question about it. Mary loved Jesus. She was a loving, devoted mother to him. Mary's love and devotion for Jesus began before he was born and lasted even beyond the cross, right? We can think of Mary as a teenage girl in Nazareth, and the last glimpse of her could be what? Where? Think about it. Where was the last glimpse of my mother with her son? We think about the cross, right? Wrong. Not at the cross with Jesus, although she was there in the last moment. Of course, with the beloved John. But John says, "Women, behold your son, and son, behold your mother." As a matter of fact, This last glimpse is not in any of the Gospels. And where is it, Pastor? In the book of Acts. Turn with me in the Luke's. In the book of Acts, chapter 1. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And there we find Acts, chapter 1. Now, I think we will find that in 34. In Acts chapter 1, verse 12, right there. Yeah. I missed it, yeah. Verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath-day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, that is Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot and Judas the son of James. These all with one mind were continually devoting themselves to prayer along with the women. Now see this? And Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. We all know that the brothers turned to Christ after the gone. And were not believers before. So we find here in the upper room Mary still involved in the ministry. Mary's love and devotion for Jesus was unquestionable. Well, we have seen on chapter 2 of Acts. Well, sorry, back to Luke actually. We find here Mary as she presented her child Jesus at the temple. Verse 34 and 35. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, but behold, the child is appointed to the fortified of many in Israel for a sign to be opposed. And a sword will pierce even your own soul to the end of those from many hearts may be revealed. Mary's heart was pierced many times because of her love for Jesus. I think about when she fled to Egypt because of the King Herod that sought their life, or his life. And I thought, secondly, that at the age of 12, remember? 12 years old, she looked desperately for Jesus for 3 days, not knowing if he was alive or dead. When Jesus was 12, they're looking for him. And also, whenever she knows the scripture, right? Whenever she reads Isaiah 53, particularly that chapter, or probably other prophets in the Old Testament about the death of the Messiah. And I just thought about how it pierced her heart. And then on that dark Friday, the Good Friday, Mary watched Jesus' hands and feet nailed to the cross. The hands and feet of Jesus once held in her hands. And now they're beating her son. Just picture that in your mind. And they killed her son, Jesus. And most of the disciples were gone. Except John. But Mary was still there, the mother who loves him. Mothers of living word, may you have Mary's kind of love and devotion for your children. I know loving your children may not always be easy. You too will have your soul pierced at times. When they are hurting, when they are sick, or maybe even when they die. And your soul will also be pierced at times by what they do sometimes. They may live a life that goes against all that you believe and hold dearly. They may even rebel against you or your God, and even reject your love. Mothers, it might happen. A mother's protection and love needs to be unwavering. It should not change. May we pray that all mothers would become like Mary. Mothers, may God look upon you with favor as you look upon Mary. She is my hero, and mothers, she should be your hero. Godly mothers knows best. You must have right godly perspective, have the right foundation, know your word. Mothers are protective of their children. Mothers should have the kind of love and devotion, just like Mary. So, God look upon Mary with favor because of who she was and who she would become. Pray first, and then we're going to have a video after that. And we'll put like the offering under this prayer. Join with me in prayer. Father, thank you for the reminder of what you have done in the heart of Mary and how she became an example to mothers today. Thank you, God, for giving us mothers here. May we continually honor them and lift them up, encourage them. And now, Lord, as we give what belongs to you, we thank you for looking after us. Thank you for providing all our needs. Thank you for loving us and answering many prayers. Thank you for giving us a home, a family, a bigger family, giving us a church, giving us people in our lives to grow in you, in your word. So, Father, thank you for what we will give. It came from your hand, and now we give that to you, what belongs to you. For your glory and honor, we pray. Amen. We're going to have a video presentation at the moment, so let's do it now. You know I love you. Mothers have to come forward. We're going to honor you and lift you up and receive the flowers as for you. So we ask now the mothers to come. All the ladies, come forward here, please. We thank the Lord for each and every one of you. Come on. We call the ladies now. Ladies. What happens if you don't have mothers, right? Oh boy, look at that. Okay. Ladies, mothers, all right. There you go. Now, we're going to pray and thank the Lord for each and every one of you first. And then we're gonna give you flowers. Roses. I don't know how we're gonna do it, but I guess that your children, I guess, could do that. Okay. Would you pray with me as we thank the Lord for each and every one of them? Now, let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for each and every mother here standing up. And those who are mothers
part of our church who are not with us today. We thank you for all of them. Thank you, God, that you've given us mothers who would become like Mary, who have the love for you, first of all, who desire to become godly mothers. We commit them to you. May ask, Lord, for your protection upon them and the strength that they need. Thank you, God, for their courage, their strength, and their willingness and their commitment to raise up children who will become part of kingdom builders. So thank you, God, for each and every one. You bless them, not only today and the days to come. Father, may we lift them up to you with gratitude that they labor, that they, what they're doing in their families and with their children, Lord, that you will equally give them special blessings. We ask, God, that you will continue to strengthen them and continue to encourage them. We pray all this in the mighty name of Christ. We celebrate with them, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're going to give them flowers, children. Okay, let's give them roses. Children, you can come up, get your rose, and go to your mom. Okay, folks, let's close in a word of prayer now. Let's close in a word of prayer. Excuse me. Let's close in a word of prayer. Excuse me. Let's pray. Okay, Father, thank you for your presence in our midst. We continue, Lord. I commit ourselves to you in the days forward as we meet again. Thank you for the food that we're going to share. Give us a good time and celebrate again our special Mother's Day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Happy birthday. Happy anniversary.
Happy birthday, sir.